I'm going to tell you a little bit about our experience, how to move data from the bench to the bedside. And my lab is actually interested in regenerative medicine and use of different kind of stem cells in this new field of medicine. And for several years, we were interested in a heart infarct or acute myocardial infarction, which actually leads to disruption in a heart function by creating the scar, which is not contractile. And it means the behavior of heart is wrong. It doesn't pump the blood the way it should. So my team already took part of a project using cells, sort of stem cells, isolated from the bone marrow. And it was published in 2009 in European Heart Journal. And actually, we saw that if you inject patients with unselected or specifically selected cells, you can have some improvement in left ventricle injection fraction. However, these changes were not very high, and actually we thought that this might be the case, because when we looked then at the engraftment using different methods, this is over the wire, this is like a balloon, and the cells actually were coming out of like this stream, and the other one, you can actually inject the cells directly toward the endothelium of the heart. And actually, as you can see, the number of engrafted cells was very, very low. It was about 5%, no matter which way we tried to inject them. And the cells, they labor radioactively, so we could actually trace them in a patients. So we decided that maybe we can use a little bit different kind of cells, and actually we moved in toward the mesenchymal stem cells, which actually are quite popular right now, and they have been tried in different diseases, and they were isolated from different sources. The way they worked is like a very pleiotropic, so they can directly actually work like by cell-to-cell contact. They can stimulate differentiation. They can use respiratory chain salvage. They can also immunomodulate, for example, inflammation. They secrete a lot of anti-inflammatory cytokine. There's some data showing that they can also differentiate directly into, for example, cardiomyocytes. But most people believe that the way they work is through the paracrine secretion. So they secrete a lot of different growth factors, cytokines, interleukins, chemokines. And by doing that, they can actually change the microenvironment. They can activate the endogenous stem cells, for example. And there's a few papers showing that mesenchymal stem cells isolated from bone marrow, for example, they can actually improve some patients with acute myocardial infarction of different other heart diseases. So actually, we created consortium, and we obtained the project from Polish agency. It was almost 37 million zloty. So at that time, it was about 10 million euros. And it was six different partners. Three of them, it was academia, Jagiellonian University. This is Technical University of Science and Technology, and also Medical University of Silesia. It was one hospital, which is actually working on the experience with patients suffering from heart diseases, and also two companies, Polish Stem Cell Bank, also Jagiellonian Center of Innovation. And it was like three major goals in this project. It was to develop a stem cell-based technology. It was another one was to develop the MRI technology. And the second was to develop the software, which actually will help to manufacture and distribute the stem cell product. And in our project, we actually were isolating mesenchymal stem cells from the Wharton jelly, which is like this jelly substance which is inside the cord, and it creates the surrounding for three vessels which are present in a cord. Actually, our preliminary data showed that the engraftment of mesenchymal stem cells isolated from the from this Wharton jelly actually very well engraft into the infarcted heart, and this engraftment was about six times higher than in case of CD34 stem cells from hematopoietic stem cells. So we did also some development, because before you introduce something directly into the patient, you have to do some developmental experiments. We did some experiment on stability of our product, showing that we can actually keep them in different temperature, and they do not lose some of the features they possess. And we were also we had to also look at the toxicity or safety. So we actually looked at the tumorogenic potential of these cells, and we compared them into the to the IPS. And as you can see, the cells, they didn't create the tumor after 90 days of culture in the mice, in opposite to IPS cells, which are pluripotent, and they have the potential to create teratomas. But another thing is, in order to have the producing line or manufacturing line, we had to establish this manufacturing facility. So actually, we created the auxiliary unit in my department, and they have about 14 people. They were working at the time, and this is the scheme how it looks like. We have a production department, quality control department, a magazine and repository unit. We have a qualifying doctors, a qualifying person. So everything according to the Polish law, which is necessary to start to manufacture the drugs or something which we can use in a clinical trial. We had to also remodel the laboratory. On the left, you can see the normal molecular biology lab, which was actually switched into the manufacturing world. And so we have to change it completely. We bought the special unit, which actually allows us to work with the cells like in the open surroundings. There's like modular unit which creates the clean room facility, and so we can actually propagate and also produce a product. We use bioreactors to do it on a large scale, and we also had some quality control specialty equipment which was specially buy to allow us to control the product at the end and also during the production line. So we created the repository. So the cord actually came. It was collected by the Polish Stem Cell Bank. They collected from different hospitals. They send it to us in a special boxes. We have to register the material, the raw material. We have to do all the processing and also the quality control. And at the end, they were put aside in the repository in liquid nitrogen. When we got the order from the hospital, from the sponsor, we actually started to produce the final product, which looked like here, and it was comprised of the cells and also some auxiliary recipients. To do this production, we have to obtain all the permits. So first of all, we got the permission from główny inspektor farmaceutyczny. So we could actually manufacture the product, and later, 2 years later, we obtained the certificate as a GMP facility. So we can actually, right now, we can not only produce the product like we did it before, we can produce also other products because we are certified GMP facility. So this is a timeline. We started in 2015 when we obtained the grant, and actually in fall 2017 we launched the clinical trial, which was actually three clinical trials. One was in acute myocardial infarction. We were supposed to recruit 105 patients. It was in a chronic ischemia, heart failure, and also 105, and also in no option lower limb ischemia, the same, it was 105 patients. And during the last 3 years, we were able to recruit all 105 patients in the AMI study and then CIHF study, and we recruited 55 patients in a clinical limb ischemia study. It was due to the low number of actually patients which were able to be introduced into this study. So right now we are in the middle of summarizing. We have some data. We didn't reach the primary endpoints in none of the study, but we were able to reach some of the secondary endpoints in the CIHF and also this critical limb ischemia. So right now we are working on the data and looking how to improve the use of the mesenchymal stem cells, and to try to maybe put another clinical trial using the data we obtained before. So, and this was the people which were involved in my lab and also in another lab at the Jagiellonian University and also in the Institute of Cardiology, the Science Technical Academy, and also in these companies which helped us. So thank you very much, and I hope I didn't exceed the time.
No, not at all. I wonder if I would like to remind that if you have any questions from audience, then please you can type it in a chat box so everyone can see it and Luther could answer. Now it's time for questions. Mm-hmm. I have on my side, I have a question to you, Professor, because this. We know that this is a very big and complex project, mm-hmm. and very challenging. And from now, from where we are standing, where you're standing now at the end of the project, almost. what do you think? Sorry, what was the most difficult part?
I would say that all of them, they were difficult because as you can see here, we have actually from obtaining the money to starting the clinical trial, it took only like 2 years. And before of that, we didn't have even the room to do it. We didn't have any equipment. So actually the first obstacle was to actually refurbish and to build this facility actually from the scratch, to build it from this, you know, so like a regular laboratory into the manufacturing space. That was one difficult stuff. Another was that, like, when we were changing the rooms and buying the equipment, at the same time, we were establishing the manufacturing line. Yeah. Okay, so we were doing all the experiments about isolation, propagation, and stuff like that. So it was also very difficult. And then I think maybe not most difficult, but also it was the part which is not here, but to obtain all the permits for a clinical trial. and also to recruit so many patients. Actually, it was these three trials, they were really big, because 105 patients is not very easy to recruit, because it was not every patient actually qualified for recruitment. So I think those were most, the three things were very difficult. And also the managing, the other five partners, that wasn't also the easy part, because actually we were the leaders. So we had to also manage the whole project, not only our part.
Amazing, amazing. So, I really look forward for the final results and the outcome.
Yeah, but as I said, we didn't reach the primary endpoints, but actually some of the secondary endpoints we were able to reach were very interesting, and probably they can set being like a starting point for another clinical trials, which actually we know already that, for example, like in these studies, we have a small population of patients called responders, which actually received the second dose of the cells. And it seems that if we at the beginning actually were injecting patients not with one but with two or even three doses, we might get better results. So it seems that there's some way to go to improve. Also, because we didn't have a chance, that's how the project was structured, we haven't do the escalation dose at the beginning. And that's another probably improvement we can do. It's to set up another clinical trial with the first maybe 20 patients, which we can try some escalation dose, to try the higher doses. Because one of the very important data we obtained, that we didn't have any severe adverse events. So it seems with this almost 300 patients, and with almost 500 injections, because in this in critical limb ischemia we injected patients three times. Every patient was injected three times with a product. We didn't observe any this adverse event. So it seems it's completely safe. So we can actually try right now to play with a dose. We can try to use higher dose, and we can also inject more than once the patients. And another one, we actually look a little bit, because in our case, we have allogeneic transplantation, so we have different donors of the cells, and it seems that some donors are better than the other. So now we can also look at our transcription, proteomic, and secretome analysis, and we can actually try to connect them with the patients which actually do the best or did the best. And it seems that some of the donors actually secrete some chemokines or growth factors in a higher amount, and these patients actually did better than the other. So that's actually quite a big room for improvement right now.
Yes, very interesting.
Yes, that's very interesting, yes.
And are you looking for partners for the further projects you mentioned?
Well, actually, we would like to look for in two ways. First of all, you would probably like to work for partners to, for example, try to obtain another grant money, to do it with different partners and and also to play with the protocol, the clinical protocol. And also we would like to look for someone who is interested in a company or something to because we would like to do the spin-off or
commercialize.
So, yes, we would like to commercialize because actually the agency would like us to do it, to commercialize our results.
Yes, but are you looking for someone to
Right. Looking for investors.
Yeah, but for the new project or for the product that you obtained in the...
You can do it like both ways.
Both. All right.
It depends on the settings and you know, the partners.
Great. I hold my fingers crossed.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. I don't see any questions. I see the chat, but I'm not sure if this is like a live.
Yes.
But I don't see any questions from the audience, so I'm not sure if...
Maybe they will come afterwards, or maybe there were no questions and the presentation was very, I mean, very, very clear and very informative. So thank you very much again, Mr. Professor. And
so I can disconnect right now, yes? Can I disconnect?
If you want, of course.
I have lab meeting, so I can come back later on.
Yes, you can. With the link I sent you again, and please feel free to join us. And thank you very much once again.
Thank you very much. Thank you.